I realized was that whatever it was horrible. It was truly horrible. And when you looked around, why, it was even worse, because there was nothing. Part of my sense of reality was gone. I was flown in like most troops, I think 2,000 or 3,000 troops, as I remember, were flown in from all over the country from different places. I flew in a dilapidated C-47. You know, it was like taking an airborne covered wagon out to see an atomic bomb go off. And it was an exciting situation because they had everything was very together. I will give them that. They just assured you just this was an exercise you were going to learn a lot. And they gave you these small mimeographed handouts, you know. Not much better than what you got from the Cub Scouts or the Boy Scouts when you were a kid, believe me, with little badly made cartoons like, you know, an atom bomb goes off and he's not in the trench, he's dead. An atom bomb goes off, he's in the trench, he lives to fight another day. That's what the whole thing was. You've got to remember, between 1951 and 1960, they had set off 100 of those bombs. They had 100 of those tests. And I saw one in June of 1953. Well, the 50s were important because there were no 1940s. Everybody thinks World War II occurred in 1940. World War II began in the 1930s. In the early 30s, you had terrible Japanese aggression in the Far East, the stock market crash, the Great Depression. Hitler then took Poland, he invaded and conquered France, and then Pearl Harbor. You know, the world was just blowing up. But by 1940, it was just a continuation of a horror that had started 3, 5, 7 years before, and was most frightening, namely because of the economic condition of the free world at the time. You know, it's weird because now that I'm telling this to you, you know, now that I'm really telling it to you, I can remember more. When we got to Camp Desert Rock, I remember it was reading those mimeographed handouts that were sobering, because as stupid and honky as they were, you know, they had some little, they had some zingers in them. Like one of them, you're going to watch an atomic explosion. Brought to you through the courtesy of the Atomic Energy Commission. You have been chosen to do this, and you will do, if you follow instructions, you will see how it's possible to go through an atomic explosion, knowing what you're going to do, and you'll live to fight another day. But you weren't supposed to take any photographs, you weren't supposed to make any notes, and you were to tell no one about what happened out there. There were periods in the 1940s when it didn't look like we were going to win the war. And then, of course, in 44, 45, we got on top of it. Germany surrendered and Italy was out of the war. Hitler was dead. There was some peace in Europe, but Japan was, the war was still going on in the Far East, so the war wasn't over. Nobody would relax. And then suddenly, in August of 1945, just like that, two atom bombs are on Japan and the war is over. Within 100 hours, two bombs hit and Japan suddenly surrenders. And the world went mad. It went mad with joy. The atomic bomb was a miracle. It was a gift from God. It ended the war. And when it ended the war in 1945, everybody said, all right, no more depression, no more war, you know, we're going to go on from here. And in effect, that was the start of the 1950s. The 1950s started in August of 1945. And then we were advised that there would be two flares, an orange flare and a red flare. The orange flare would go off signaling there was 5 minutes. The red flare would go off signaling there was 2 minutes. And you were to be in the trench. And then there was to be a 30-second countdown. And then we could see the tower. It was, it looked like a giant erector set. There was all flood lit. And there were a lot of these technicians climbing up and down, and they had come out in jeeps, and they were wiring up everything. And then while that going on, all of a sudden the orange flare went off, and you thought, well, 5 minutes. The magnitude of the bomb, which I knew nothing about, got to me because of the vibes of the place. It was awesome. It was really awesome, and nothing had happened yet. And I think, like everybody, we got in the trench, and that's when we discovered the goddamn trench was only less than 5 feet deep. I mean, you know, when you stood in the trench, why, your chest and shoulders stood out, and you thought they could have at least dug this a little deeper for us or something, but it was too late for that. Then, when the red flare went off, we noticed that most of these technicians had finished, and they were driving away, they were speeding away in this. I don't blame them, but the way that they were getting out of there didn't make you feel much better. And then I thought, well, you know, don't spend your time do that. You better get down. So I was ready to turn and get down, and this sergeant who was next to me, and I think he had the squad I was supposed to end in charge of. And I remember I was a little surprised because he turned to me and he said, hey, kid, do you know how to cover your holes? And he really was telling me something, and I think he totally forgot himself. And he said, it might be smart to cover your holes, and you do that like this. You take your thumbs, and you press those earlobes into your ears, you see? And then you take the two strong fingers, and you get them in your eyes, and you pull those lids down, you see? And then you take the little fingers, and you close those nostrils. Now, don't worry about your mouth. Your mouth is tough. You can hold that. And I knelt down in that trench, and I faithfully covered my holes, and I tightened my mouth, and it was one of the weirdest moments of my life. But it wasn't even a moment. It wasn't even a moment. It was just a long kind of time, just kept on going, but it didn't want to be registered. With the atom bomb, science and materialism, science and militarism reign supreme, you know, and we reign supreme. No one at first appreciated the horror of the atomic bomb. You know, and I don't think in a sense, and I'm just speaking, you know, how I remember it on the street and how, you know, my parents and teachers were remembering. That miracle, that wonderful scientific miracle of the atomic bomb went on until all of a sudden in 1949, the Russians exploded their own. Then all of a sudden it started. When it came to the point that what happened to Hiroshima or Nagasaki could happen to London or Paris or Chicago, you know, then it was terrible. And to meet this challenge, America set out to really, in a sense, take over the world. The Beats were the first to really say, you know, this isn't necessarily an arms race. This is just mad science being fueled by matter materialism. You know, because the power was not out of having a bomb or a missile, the power was out of having the economics. That's why the Beats were right, and that's why they were the guiding light of a changing consciousness, and they still are. And that's really why the Beats continue to haunt the American mind. Yeah. Well, it was the orange flare, and then the red flare, and then there was this odd, weird silence, you know what I mean? And I was in the trench, I covered my holes, and I was trying to dig my way. I thought maybe I could get a foot deeper with my elbows and my knees, but it was pretty hard ground. As a matter of fact, it was rocky, almost rocky ground. And then this curious voice, this weird, weird, curious voice began that 30-second countdown. This weird pronunciation, 30, 20, 29, and it just seemed to drag on. You think the guy would cause the atom bomb to be canceled or something. And yet it was recording, I found out later, on top of the tower. And it went on, and it went on, and it went on, and it gave you more time to try to dig into the tower, and pretty soon my elbows hurt, you know. And then finally, 2, 1, 0.